doing Scientology counseling, but on the flip side, you're like so critical, like this like spearheader in the fight against Scientology, saying L. Ron Hubbard's a con man, then you go and take people into session for $2,500. She doesn't want to come under scrutiny because she is this big critic and she doesn't want people to know she's secretly charging all this money to get people to go into session. I'm at the very bottom pits of my life, comes in, asks for my wallet more or less to get the $7,000 from a kid who's basically on the verge of filing bankruptcy, on the verge of a divorce, never talking to my family ever again, having no friends, no job money, no prospect of that, knowing that I have bad credit, I have debt collectors knocking on my door, and if I was just paying cash, I could have paid, you know, however many hours that is, 70 hours of therapy for $7,000, right? 70 hours can get you a lot of good mental health resources. But this person insists that I pay them so they can go talk to the cable guy in the middle of sessions asking me, like, name someone else you can communicate. Thank you. Name someone else you could. Thank you. Hey, all you cool cats and kittens, and welcome to Mangotology. If you're new here, let me introduce myself to you. My name is Stephen Mango, and I'm an ex-Scientologist that works here on YouTube to expose Scientology. If you'd like to stay up to date on all my videos, please make sure to go down below, hit that red subscribe button, and turn on your bell notifications, and you'll get an alert whenever I release a new video exposing Scientology. And for today's video, we are going to be talking all things independent Scientology, also known as the Free Zone. We are going to be talking about the lies, the fraud, the deception, what it is not, including my experience when I was actually in independent Scientology. I'm going to be sharing stories that I've never shared here before on my channel, including the story about how one of Scientology's most famous critics, who is an auditor, ripped me off for up to $7,500. So if you'd like to hear that story, including everything I just said, then keep on watching. Hey again, guys, I hope that you are all doing well during this whole quarantine time. I know I start off pretty much all of my quarantine videos by saying that, but I really do mean it and hope that you guys are all doing well. You're all like my family who tune into my videos and are all Mangotologists out there. So I hope that you guys are staying safe, staying indoors, social distancing, washing your hands, and hopefully when things are safe to do so, we can open back up again and the world can continue on as normal. And during this time, I've had a lot of different video ideas, but I've kind of fell down the rabbit hole, if you will, with regard to independent Scientology and, or also known as Free Zone Scientology. It's a subject that I've kind of shied away from talking about on my channel just due to the stigma of it. And there's a lot of different misconceptions and ideas and everything about independent Scientology and claims that I've been a practicing Scientologist outside of Scientology. So I'm gonna clear all that up and kind of share my story and experience and everything that I just said in my intro here for you guys. So if you don't know what independent Scientology is, I believe in my personal experience, it kind of derived more or less from Marty Rathbun. You guys know who Marty Rathbun is. He was a former high up senior official in Scientology. And when he left along with Mike Rinder, they started basically or tried to assemble all the other ex-Scientologists together to have a independent Scientology community or movement, which would have basically Marty Rathbun and Mike Rinder together kind of spearheading this movement to where there would be Scientology without the really harsh ethics punishments. There wouldn't be family disconnections. There wouldn't be like the really evil, like toxic policies of Scientology. It would more or less be a movement that would allow others to get the spiritual wins and gains, if you will, of Scientology without necessarily needing to step foot into the organization or under the dictatorship of David Miscavige. And back in the years, I would say, again, don't quote me on the exact years, but it was around the years 2009-ish, where a lot of different people, such as like the Headleys and like other people who now no longer probably are, or we know that they're not, Mike Rinder's not a independent Scientologist. At that time, it was a nice stepping stone into the real world with still being able to practice some level of Scientology since, you know, years of being involved in Scientology, you're still gonna have some of that brainwashing and you're still gonna believe in the technology. And Mike and Marty used to make all these different videos and Marty used to give briefings. And here's just a couple of short little clips so you guys can kind of see what I'm talking about.
Howdy. Coming at you straight from the heart of the shack in Ingleside, Texas. This is the first of a few short briefings that I wanted to give because I found that, and speaking with others, we've kind of decided that we are at a major crossroads in the independence movement.
As you can see an example of here, Marty Rathbun would sit down and go fishing with Mike Rinder, and they would discuss different problems within the Church of Scientology, as well as discussing the independent field. And basically, it seemed like almost every other day, someone new was coming outside of Scientology and was declaring their independence of Scientology and joining the Free Zone movement under Marty Rathbun, and he would share and introduce new people who would come out onto his blog as new independent Free Zone Scientologists.
So this went on for a few years, and basically it didn't end up going anywhere. Marty was getting stalked by the squirrel busters, and they'd have Scientologists coming in, raiding in, saying that Marty was a squirrel, meaning that he's like squirreling the technology. I guess it doesn't really explain it that well, but he's kind of corrupting Scientology's technology or not delivering it in accordance to how Scientology would deliver it, with like a course, or rather a case supervisor with all the different terminals in an org that would typically be in place in order to run a standard Scientology session. And that's what Scientology's main thing is with these independent Scientologists, are they're not able to deliver Scientology appropriately because they don't have all the different people that would be a part of the Scientology experience that make it be like a true Scientology session, according to Hubbard. So I guess kind of briefly before I get into my story about how I was ripped off in the independent world and my experience in there, I should kind of preface it a little bit before I kind of go into my whole thing, just to say that I've always considered myself and still consider myself a very spiritually minded person. And that's what the most difficult part of leaving Scientology has been for me, is that I don't feel like I have like that spiritual side of me or that community or something that I've felt as passionately about as I did about Scientology. I've explored all different type of things and nothing has ever given me that true like sense of purpose and identity and what I felt in Scientology. Nothing's kind of fit in the same way. Everything's been kind of like, okay, that's nice, whatever, but I never felt as like my whole heart and soul as like this rings so true to me, right? And that's why I initially, when I first left Scientology in 2013, got involved with auditing in the independent Scientology world. Again, very briefly, I do not consider myself a Scientologist now. I need to make that very clear to you guys that I'm not promoting Scientology here on my channel, and I am not a Hubbard apologist, I'm not a David Miscavige apologist or anything like that. I'm just telling you what works for me, what doesn't, and I'm gonna kind of debunk if there actually is good in this independent Scientology world and what is the scams. And there's a lot of different things that I want you guys to be aware of. But yeah, I mean, even now to this day, like you guys have seen in the background of my videos before, I have a Zohar and I scan the Zohar, which I go through basically an Aramaic Bible, essentially, and I scan over the Aramaic and other times Hebrew symbols in order just to feel like their energy and their power. And I do different things that people might think are weird, but I still find that there's not one right answer to spirituality. And I do think that if you guys want to practice a form of spirituality or get counseling, or if you were so inclined to ever do Scientology auditing, which I'm not recommending because again, it's brainwashing and you're doing Scientology drills and hypnotic commands, and there's a whole nother video about that. But there are people, if you have two like-minded people together who have good intentions, who are pure-hearted and want to help elevate each other up, I don't see a problem if someone had a background in Scientology and was using some of the tools if they genuinely wanted to help someone, because there are good principles in Scientology. But again, for the handful of nice concepts to have to be under years and years of trauma, it's not worth it. Obviously, my life would be so much better if I didn't have or didn't underwent years of brainwashing and mind control and manipulation and being in a codependent relationship with Scientology and the heartache. And you guys see this all the time on my channel. I'm not erasing any of that by the comment I just made. I'm just saying that there doesn't necessarily mean that it's bad to have some different independent Scientology things going on. Now, I got ripped off for a lot of money by a very famous critic, which you're gonna be spilling the tea about. And, you know, it just kind of made me think about when I was planning on making this video is there good in independent Scientology? The issues with independent Scientology first, though, are that there's no centralized group, and that could be a good and a bad thing. The bad thing is if you have someone who comes in with bad intentions, who's just trying to manipulate you or control you or take your money. There's not someone to report that to. There's not like an org or a church or someone that can kind of handle those type of complaints. I don't know if you're getting delivered proper Scientology, if that's what you're looking for in the independent world. A lot of people develop their own little procedures and stuff, and then they're charging a lot of money. These auditors charge hundreds of dollars an hour, so you have to understand that. There's that. There's a lot of different ideas. Some people believe in these policy letters, some people don't. Other people believe that you have to audit with one swing of the floating needle. Other people believe it has to be done another way, right? So there's all these different concepts and ideas. And again, this all is deriving from Hubbard though too. So you guys have to realize that as well, that everything's based in Hubbard and it's based on his policy letters from 50s to the 80s, right? So that doesn't necessarily mean that Scientology's ever been able to evolve. It can evolve. It's under one person's ideas and you have to follow Hubbard to the T. And that's what's dangerous. No matter which way you swing it, if you're doing it in my living room or you're doing it in a Scientology org, you're still doing processes of L. Ron Hubbard. So just keep that in mind as well with independent Scientology. There's even been a big scandal recently about this guy. He's claiming his name was like Justin Craig maybe or something like that. And he changed his name legally to L. Ron Hubbard. And I actually tried to get an interview with him, but he knew that I was a critical channel, so he wouldn't let me interview him after all, or he blocked me or something. But he actually got a lot of famous auditors and critics and people under his wing. He developed Scientology 2.0, and again, his name is L. Ron Hubbard because he originated in some Scientology independent auditing session that he is L. Ron Hubbard, and he wants to take over the church again, and he returned. Really, he's this convicted felon, and he's had like carjacks and like all these different like crazy things that he's done in his life. So basically a criminal trying to act like L. Ron Hubbard to try to amass following. And that's what a lot of these independent auditors do. They want to have a cult. They try to rope people in and then manipulate them and trick them in their own ways. And what happened to me was, I think, a very dangerous experience. So that's why I want to share it with you guys so you can hear what happened. I'm also going to preface this by saying that I've been scared to ever speak out about this experience. And I've told my husband I was thinking about making this video, and he advised me not to, just because this person is very manipulative and they do not have a good reputation anymore in the ex-Scientology community, because they still like talk behind in the other like back channel groups, and they try to like fair game certain people, and they'll have like all these different fake bots like messaging about you, and they'll try to get dirt on you and private investigators sort of level type of things, because this is all that they do, is have their own little world where they try to get other people to do their bidding and stuff like that, if you will. And again, I do not dislike this person, and I'm not trying to expose them because I'm not saying their name. I'm sure you guys could probably guess who I'm talking about, and I highly advise not, you know, mentioning the comments and stuff like that, because that's not what the message of this is. But it's more or less saying that, you know, there are good intentions and bad intentions of people. And I've had other auditors when I was in Scientology or left Scientology, again, short-lived when I was receiving auditing, but you know, there's great people, you know, such as Trey Lotz, who he's an independent Scientologist. He's been auditing since I think 1969 or something like that. And you know, he knew Hubbard personally. And even though he's delivering the technology of Scientology, I feel that his true intention is like, I'm a counselor, I want to help people, and from like a spiritual point of view. And he doesn't care if I was gay and like all those different things that Scientology would, you know, judge you about. Because how could you go and feel like you can get counseling if you're being interrogated by the person for who you really are, like inside Scientology's walls? So I can understand if people do believe in Scientology, why they would want to see one of these independent Scientologists, because you can't feel relieved if you have like the suppressive nature of Scientology. Again, if you believe in those sort of terms. And this is a very real thing about the Scientology world, rather. And it's something that I feel like we should talk about as an independent and free zone Scientology. And I should make some videos about it, because it is a part of the culture of the world of Scientology. And it's another level of deception, another layer of manipulation. And let's talk about the story about my experience and why I feel deceived from this one experience. Because like I said, there's good and bad in this world. And this was kind of the straw that broke the camel's back of why I kind of left the independent Scientology movement. And obviously once Marty Rathbun dismantled his independent community and stuff, I feel like when more people were speaking out, again, wasn't as heavy-handed of activism back then than there is now, and the amount of films that come out and documentaries. So you guys have to realize it was a different time in the Marty Rathbun leading this movement. And I know that people, you know, can switch back to not believing in Scientology, and that's fine. I'm not judging this person who did audit me for it, but you have to realize too that I think you guys are going to see the picture add up on why I feel the way I do, and I'm really curious to hear what you guys think about this as well. So the first thing we have to do is rewind back to 2013. Damaged, I'm broken. I just started coming out with my sexuality. Like, obviously I met Jeff, my husband, and I was just coming out of the closet, just coming to terms with accepting myself. I left Scientology. I was on the posters the same time I was like escaping. So it was a really huge loss for me. And even though I knew Scientology was a cult, even though I knew about the technology not being on the up and up in a lot of different ways, like I knew that there were a lot of broken and missing pieces and stuff like that. But you have to understand, when I invested my life of my adulthood of 18 to 21 or 22, like those were the times I should have been getting my life going with college or going to get my acting career going, and that was failing. I had a business that tanked. Like I was doing work in public relations for actors and stuff, and the type of service I offered kind of crumbled with technology, so I wasn't able to offer that anymore. And of course with disconnection, I no longer was able to run that business. So that was tanking. I had $50,000 of debt from Scientology, and I didn't have good family relationships or friendships because I disconnected from those people in my life as well. So I was completely having like an identity crisis. I was broken and I had no idea what to do with myself because I still felt like there was like, I don't know, like there was just like a piece of me that was missing. And even though there was obviously so much going on that was wrong and I felt relieved to be out, I still felt like, ooh, like that purpose I had was like missing. So my husband contacted this independent Scientology auditor who's a very famous critic and said, hey, like, can you talk to my boyfriend at the time? And he's having a really hard time, and I'd really appreciate, since you were high up in the organization as one of your top auditors, I'd appreciate if you, you know, maybe could talk to him. Maybe like you can get through to him or explain like something, or you can speak the same language more or less. So this person came over for dinner and they were so keen on having me speak out and tell my story. And I'm like, you know what? I'm not ready. And they were just kind of like relaying about their experiences in the organization and stuff like that. And I started taking a great liking towards this person. And I started looking at them, even though we didn't have that close of a relationship, but I still kind of consider this person like a maternal figure to me because I didn't have that in my life. And here's someone who actually communicated to me in a manner which I felt loved and cared about in a lot of different ways. So I would also understand too, because I know I'm gonna get judgment for this, that I signed up for this, and I'm gonna get into that. But you have to understand that this person left the Sea Org, I think in the 90s, but at this point they were already out of Scientology longer than I was. And they are a millionaire with their own business. They have housekeeper, they have staff, they have all of that. So you have to understand, this isn't like someone was trying to like make a living off of me by trying to like audit me and they had nothing else. And I would completely almost understand and like give them credit, like, okay, this poor person left the Sea Org and they're trying to make a couple extra dollars as an auditor. This person was a millionaire. And meanwhile, I was broken. I had nothing. I could barely afford anything. I couldn't afford my apartment. I moved in with Jeff. Like basically my life was in shambles. So I started talking to this person and kind of expressing some of the different negative things that were going on in my life. And they're like, hey, I'm, say for example, if auditors go from class 0 to class 12, say they're like a class 12. I'm a class 12 auditor. I've audited thousands of hours of Scientology auditing. Like, let's go into session and handle these different things and like get you up the bridge. And this was after all explaining about my acting career, explaining about like my loss of Scientology, just everything in my life just being a mess. And they're like, well, if you go up the bridge, then you're gonna raise your tone level essentially. You're no longer gonna have like these issues in your life and you're gonna be able to ascend to higher spiritual states. Now, I didn't opt in right away. What happened was Jeff had two dogs, Beauregard and Lily, before we got married, and they both died within a year of each other. I was very traumatized because I'm an animal person. This was the first dog I ever kind of like had because I was living with him, and I was traumatized from the loss of the dog, both of them, and so was he. And now I'm like, okay, I don't have these two furry animals that were like my companions. So this person's like, hey, I'll take you in a session for free. Okay, I'm holding the cans and relaying over and over again about the trauma of losing the dog until it kind of lifted off and felt like a relief that, okay, like I understand, you know, that dogs die or like whatever the realization was, it was old, but it was more or less that they're a spirit and they're gonna live on again. And this person had like other sort of like Scientology ideas. They told me to leave bowls of food out for the dog so that the spirit would still feel like we didn't forget about him or her, right? From our direct messages, I said, so sorry, we woke up and 3 hours later she was gone. She said, fully understood. I pick up that she is around in the house. For the next 10 days, put out food and water for her just as if she is there. Telepathically talk to her. Ask her to come back to you in another poodle form. Put out the food and water for her as a ritual. They pick up a new body, they would still feel like they're part of our family, right? So it was like all again this like Scientology indoctrination. But again, I didn't have a lot of Scientology auditing up until that point. So I felt like this person was kind of putting me under the Scientology spell when I probably could have even recovered from my Scientology stuff faster. This person was almost like re-hypnotizing me into the Scientology mindset of going into session and taking vitamins and all of that sort of thing. And later on, again, it wasn't like an instant, like, oh my God, sign me up for all this auditing. They, again, cell auditing in 12 and a half hour intensive, just like Scientology does, $2,500 an intensive. Celebrity Center was charging $3,600 at the time I left, so it wasn't really too far off in price, a little bit cheaper than what Scientology was. But again, they're claiming that they can fix my case so much faster and get me up the bridge and get rid of my reactive mind, yada, yada, yada. So I started, I would say, having, and again, I'm just being honest with you guys, having some relationship problems. And it was stemming from Jeff and I just only having known each other for a very short time. We fell in love very fast, and within a couple months later, we were married. So we started butting heads when it was like, oh, honey, guess what? I have $50,000 of debt from Scientology. Oh, guess what? I was much more involved than you thought I was. Oh, guess what? Like, just like things like that. My business, you know, tanked. Now I can't get it to go back up. I was a kid. I was 20 years old. I didn't know how to be in a relationship with someone. I thought at 20 years old, I knew how a business would work. I thought I could fix my business and I couldn't. And I was just like, okay, I'll put a little bit more money into it, a little bit more money into it. And I never could save it. So again, there was tension. I'm like, oh my God, is he going to leave me? Because Gary thinks that different than I said I was. And now we've been together for 8 years and things are fine in that regard. It was a very vulnerable place for me to feel like, oh my God, now what? You know, like I'm like, okay, I don't have my family, I don't have my friends, I don't have my spouse, you know, he's distant from me, right? And I don't have money, everything is crumbling. And this person's like, the only way you can get all that back and I can save all of this for you is if you pay me for the auditing. I kind of would reason it the same way as if I said I have healing powers with my fingers. And say my neighbor has coronavirus and I go over and say, hey, I can cure your coronavirus holistically with my fingers, but I need $8,000. I can get the $8,000 from that person maybe if I manipulated them well and because they're in a vulnerable place in their life. Yes, the person could have handed me their credit card on their own accord, but that doesn't mean that it's ethically the right thing to do. I was in such a place where this person knew how much money I turned over to Scientology, and I think they knew how weak-minded and naive I was and how much of a believer I sort of still was, that I think that they took it as an opportunity to rope me into their independent Scientology cult movement, sort of group or whatever you'd want to call it. So I definitely think it's an ethical violation, more or less, more than anything. Like, yes, I handed the credit card over. I know the comments. I know what people are already thinking, rolling their eyes. How do you get sucked into it again? But I didn't think of it any different than like going to a therapist's office at the time. Like, I didn't believe in mental health therapy. I didn't believe in psych drugs. I didn't believe in all those different things that a normal person would turn to, or relationship counseling or whatever. Like, all I knew was Scientology was the way to fix things, because I was only out for a couple months at this time. Like, you can't really blame me. Like, if I did it now, it's different than if I did it then. But I feel like this person knew. After being out, this person runs several critical blogs and Facebook groups and stuff like that. And you guys are going to hear like how weird the sessions and stuff are in a second. So I don't know if I got two or three intensives. It was either $5,000 minimum I spent, up to $7,500. I don't recall. I do know that this person offered to see Jeff and I private or together and privately. in like a way to try to sell auditing as like relationship counseling. They wanted to basically do like overts and withhold write-ups, like what crimes did you commit against Jeff? What did he commit against you, right? And doing it as if like we've been like up to no good type of thing or whatever, like just ethics sort of stuff. And she asked Jeff for $10,000. As you can see in a direct message she sent to me here, the money will ultimately save in the long run is huge, but I want to be realistic. There are layers and layers to handle in both of you. My estimate to complete this marriage counseling is 50 hours. 25 hours will be you in the hot seat, and 25 hours will be with Jeff in the hot seat. 50 hours is not a lot given that it is a game changer for your marriage. And of course, 12 and a half hours with this auditor is $2,500. So given that that is 4 intensives of auditing, that comes out to $10,000.
Of course he said no, he doesn't believe in Scientology at the time. He still didn't. He didn't think it'd work. He's like, we can go in on our own insurance more or less to be able to receive counseling if that's what we wanted to. We resolved our problems luckily, and that's in the past. But I think it's just an important element so you guys can see, like, I moved in with this person now, like, oh my God, I have no money. I don't, like, my whole life just felt like it was like crumbling. This person was offering to help me, but it was almost how someone has a knife holding at your back. But it's like, I'm your best friend. And I knew that they just wanted the money from me, more or less. So I go in a session with this person, I remember once, and this is a big no-no in Scientology world, but holding the cans and I'm in a session, reliving some type of pain in my life that I have to recall in the session, or whatever things that they're asking. Again, it was true Scientology. They made me sign a form saying it's life coaching. It wasn't. I was on the e-meter. They were calling out floating needles. I'd have to attest in exams, like all the normal things that you do in Scientology auditing. I would show policy letters. There were Scientology books. So this person one time left the session in the middle, goes, oh honey, like the doorbell's ringing. Like I have to go help the cable guy. Would go out to help the cable person and left for 30 minutes of the session or however long it was, maybe even longer than that. So I'm sitting there looking at the cans like, are they coming back? And on the folder, they write down how long the session was so they can tally up to see when's the next time to charge you again. So it said, say 1 to 2:30 was the session. They didn't subtract the 30 minutes they were gone. So I was literally paying like say $250 to $500 an hour for this person to go to the cable guy. And again, what in Scientology's world, like you're triggered, you're in the middle of an incident, then they just stop the session. It's like such a no-no in the Scientology world. This was like regular counseling or therapy or something, but this is supposed to be like this highly trained auditor is like, I can help change your life and give you all these special powers. And like in the middle of the session, they're going to talk to the cable person. Like I just felt like it was like stuff like that that was going on. And what would happen as well is they'd come before the session and after, like say I would arrive at 3 p.m. they wouldn't come in the auditing room till 4 p.m. because they'd be on these critical blogs that I wasn't really privy on a lot in the beginning. I didn't really know the extent of how big of a critic they were against Scientology. I thought they were like a believer in it more or less, but I come to find out they weren't. It was just like a money-making thing in my opinion, because they'd go on these Facebook groups while she's like, heat up the cans, right? Because the cans get old and you have to heat them up or whatever. So I would do that on the heater and they wouldn't come in for an hour, this person, because they'd be on all these blogs on two computers going like this with their partner, writing all these scathing blog posts about L. Ron Hubbard, all the lies about the technology. This person's on camera saying the state of Clear doesn't exist. They've audited all these people and no one has wins and like all this sort of stuff. So they knew exactly what was going on with Scientology. When I was like a young 20-something, naive, new fleed person from the cult, I just escaped and here's this person saying like, I'm gonna help you and I'm gonna take you under my wing like a mommy bear type of thing. But really, they knew all along what was happening. And I was just their latest like sucker to buy into their deception, more or less. So they'd come in after like an hour and be like, hey, the cans aren't heated up. Then they'd go back off onto their Facebook forum and like typing out all these things to people and inviting people in their Facebook group who like hate Scientology. So it was stuff like that that was going on. And I didn't realize it till a lot later that I was like duped by this person. And they would, you know, try to use me to like be like a pawn in their like little Scientology games of like, okay, we have to come against this person. Like, we need you to post this. I have a little bit of dirt on Marty Rothbund. Could you post it on your channel and I'll repost it on my Twitter page or whatever. Like, I'll pump you up. I'll promote all your videos and all your different things, but you have to like put out certain things. Like, they try to control the ex-Scientology narrative.
Here are a couple examples of that from my direct messages. Steve, dear, please block that Twitter account. They crave attention, and the only way to stop them connecting with you is a block. It seems to be Virginia McLaughlin, but it smacks of an OSA op. The Twitter account has 7 followers and 2 posters. LOL. Here's another example of a conversation we had in my direct messages. She gave me information about Marty Rathbun that she wanted to be leaked, and she didn't want to do it herself, so she gave that information to me, but she had a problem that I implied that it came from someone such as her, and trying to kind of control how I presented the information in my video, she said. Very good. One thing I wish you had pumped up more is Marty Rathbun misconduct on the set. Screaming, attacking, fighting like someone unhinged. Going off like a firecracker when he did not agree. Perhaps you can add in comments. You need to show how unstable he is. On a borderline meltdown with no manners and a street thug mentality. This can be conveyed by describing the incidents you eyewitnessed on the set of the making of the movie, My Scientology Movie. She goes on, if you keep flip-flopping in your position, you will lose all credibility. After you made videos telling the world how pleased Marty was, smiling and nodding, praising the David Miscavige actor, etc., you are now blaming the movie for his mental issues. This is damaging to your credibility in all your videos. Please don't post drivel about how the movie was to blame. It's utter rubbish. I don't like blatant falsehood posted on Outer Banks, the Facebook group. If he felt such, he could have bailed out of the production at any time. Again, if I have a difference of opinion or if I shared something in my video based on my own observations and it wasn't in agreement with her or the narrative she wanted to be told, then I would get reprimanded when it's like, just go on your own channel and make the video then if you have a problem with what I have to say.
And they'll be like, yeah, we can get you media interviews. I'm going to talk to different people, like to get your story out there. So I'm like, oh, they're supporting me and giving me a bigger platform. But really it was because they wanted to kind of be a little bit more behind the scenes, but have a lot of other people speaking out about Scientology instead of just like one person just solely coming at Scientology, if that makes any sense. I'm not saying that they're incorrect about what they say. It's not like anyone's lying about their experience or anything like that. Obviously, it's all in the name of exposing Scientology, but I feel like this person knew that they could get and extract money out of me. They made me put it on credit cards, on my PayPal, and send them the money, kind of like under the table, more or less, to go into session. I know that this person too, you guys would be so surprised. So like one of the biggest critics, and I was told by a friend of mine that's an ex-Scientologist, like a second generation person, that this person was still auditing as of 2 years ago, that this person's friend went to this person's house and was told, oh, this so-and-so is still in session, and was trying to get this person to go in session perhaps, or I don't really know exactly 100% about why that other person was at this person's house, but I do know that they were still auditing people as of 2 years ago. This person's on documentaries or helping with documentaries on different things, and they're then going into session taking people in. Like, do you guys see like the ethical like thing about that? Like, you're taking people into session doing Scientology counseling, but on the flip side you're like so critical, like this like spearheader in the fight against Scientology, saying L. Ron Hubbard's a con man, then you go and take people into session for $2,500. Like, that's not like, I would, again, almost, I don't think it's right, but if they just left Scientology with nothing, I would almost understand why they do that. This person's a millionaire, has their own successful business, a huge collection of a certain something, and there's no need for them to need to offer Scientology auditing. Now, maybe that's changed recently, but from the reports I've gotten about this person, it appears that they're still taking people into session. So I went with this person from ARC Straightwire, the lower bridge, and they took me up to grade 2. Again, I couldn't afford to go further, and I knew that the sessions are a little interesting, but at least. I'm not saying that there wasn't some good elements of being able to have someone at the time who understood and listened to me, but again, I feel like it was a pay to play. If I didn't have money, I couldn't get help from this person. Or just in general, like, that's what it's like with the ex-Scientology kind of community. There's people willing to help you for the same price tag, but then again, they do the same type of revenge tactics as Scientology does. So these people are almost no better than the Church of Scientology when it's like they're just doing it on the outside world. They're trying to control people. They're trying to manipulate them. And what was just kind of like the straw that broke the camel's back as well about this whole entire situation was in 2017, I was again just in a very dark place, and I took like 14 pills or something like that. Like, again, in a suicide attempt. There was also another time when I was attempting suicide when I drove to Las Vegas with the intent to kill myself by jumping off a balcony at the Cosmopolitan Hotel in Las Vegas.
and over there in the middle of the night, and I made all these cryptic Facebook posts, and I was talking about how, you know, I'm going to drink and gamble my pain away, and then I'm gonna, you know, end my life, and just like these really cryptic posts. Now this person, whether you would say they're my auditor, my life coach, whatever way you want to spin it, was liking those posts, but didn't necessarily go to reach out for emergency service. They didn't go to help me in any form or fashion that would be helping me. This person didn't reach out to my husband, didn't like do anything to try to help me in that point. And again, I'm going in a session with this person right around the same time. So again, I'm a product of their service. They're trying to say that they're helping me with my life. But then again, if I'm at this dark place, maybe refer me to mental health services or like something that would be better instead of saying to come back in session. So this person's telling me, again, I have the DMs and stuff I could show you guys, but
here we are discussing the suicide attempt. It's not just about the job. I've been depressed on and off for months. I took 14 pills in February to kill myself and end up in the emergency room. She said, sheesh. Then she continues, in regard to talking to my spouse, she said, you can tell him when you decide to get outside help that you're not comfortable with licensed therapists. Their stats are terrible. They do not have a clue as a general rule. In regard to getting me to pay her $200 to $250 an hour to audit me instead of trying to get actual mental health counseling, which I think is very dangerous and very irresponsible. She said, Steve, as you know, I spent many long years to get the expertise I have. It was brutal, 60 to 80 hour weeks, no days off, burning the midnight oil. I achieved the apex and can crack anything. I charge $200 an hour for my services. I know a couple of class 8s that charge the same, and they are not even class 12s and not flag trained. I charge $200 an hour, whether in session or marriage counseling. She then goes on to say, be sure you post that you are totally healthy and mentally well. This is the kind of information that OSA will use to trash your film and video. They will twist it and use it. Certain things should be kept private. I said, yes, I've been posting for days and weeks. I am doing a study. I'll clarify, because I entered a paid drug clinical trial study in order to make money because I was desperate to make money around the same time, because this is the time when I was being chased down by debt collectors and other people that I owed money to with regard to leaving Scientology. And so she didn't like that I was mentioning publicly that I was being a guinea pig for a clinical trial. She said, good, a mental health clinical trial is not good for your PR, whether you are well or not.
They basically told me, like, oh, don't go see a mental health therapist. Like, they have really bad stats. Like, they have bad statistics of, like, helping people. And don't see a mental health professional. And come in session with me, $200 an hour, or however much it is, $250 an hour. And it's like, are you kidding? Like, it's, like, so dangerous. And that's what I'm saying. Like, if you want to do independent Scientology, I'm not saying that I recommend that in any stretch of the imagination. But there are other people, like, if you were doing a session with them, that they might try to help you, or maybe you get some sort of spiritual benefits out of it. But again, this is like the same type of thing. You write success stories. It's like the same sort of thing where you have to do that in order to get to the next level in Scientology, in the independent world as well. And I was under control of maybe like a narcissist or like a manipulative person. Like, yeah, like maybe they invited me out to a couple dinners or invited me to their house for a holiday. But again, I paid them to do that. Like, you know what I mean? I gave them thousands of dollars in the same sort of vein. And I feel much more ripped off than I did even with Scientology, because Scientology is a cult, no matter what way you spin it. You guys know, I don't have to tell you guys all the different reasons why it is. But this is a person who left, who's painting themselves as a helpful soul that when I'm at the very bottom pits of my life, comes in, asks for my wallet more or less to get the $7,000, $5,000, however much it was, but thousands of dollars from a kid who's basically on the verge of filing bankruptcy, on the verge of a divorce, on the verge of having, you know, never talking to my family ever again, having no friends, no job money, no prospect of that, knowing that I have bad credit, debt collectors knocking on my door. And instead of saying like, hey, hun, maybe when you could afford to do auditing, if you ever wanted to do that, you could pay me if that was like, or I'll give you a reduced rate, I'll charge you $50 an hour, or 25, whatever it is, and I'll help you. Or I can like do it as like a loaning basis, like I can give you a little bit of auditing and then maybe later on in the future you could pay me, whatever. I would almost understand that sort of notion behind it. But when you're, instead of being like maybe payback American Express or Capital One or whoever it is, or getting $7,000 of actual counseling, which could be like up to 100 hours of therapy, like if I was just paying cash, I could have paid, you know, however many hours that is, 70 hours of therapy for $7,000, right? 70 hours can get you a lot of good mental health resources. This person insisted I pay them so they can go talk to the cable guy in the middle of sessions asking me, like, name someone else you can communicate. Thank you. Name someone else you could. Thank you. What is the definition of the word help? Like, name another way you can help someone, or doing like light, or whatever it is, recall a happy moment in your life. But it wasn't just that. It was like, maybe this person's suppressive. Don't talk to these other ex-Scientologists. Like, they're against me, so don't talk to them. And they would say stuff like that to me, like, well, we don't like XYZ. We don't like this person. And this person's an enemy of ours. And like, kind of like gossiping on the back channel. So this is like, again, ex-Scientology world, guys, mind you. And that's why I've distanced myself from it. That's why you guys don't see me going to the events of ex-Scientology and stuff, because there's a lot of similar aspects in the anti-Scientology world. And there's some great people. I've known some people who are like amazing that I still talk to, who are wonderful, but a lot of other people, like, say like you don't like Tony Ortega. I get unfriended by people. If I say anything negative about Tony Ortega, or if I like am a little bit critical, because again, I don't kiss anyone's ass, I ask critical questions about things, then I'd have people unfriending me instantly, overnight. Like, same as I told you, if I disagree with Tony Ortega, if I disagree with other sort of popular critics, boom, like, you're unfriended. It will never talk to you again. It's kind of like they have like these little cliques of groups, and there's like these charismatic people. And I never want to be that. I never want, like, if anyone ever like overly love bombs me, it's like, don't do that. Like, I don't like that, because I don't like feeling like I'm a guru to you guys when I'm sharing my stories and experiences and heartfelt activism work that I do. And it's taken me a long time to come forward about this, because this person, again, is intimidating, because they can go and they control a lot of the different ex-Scientology message boards and different groups and different things. And I'm not in a place in my life where I want drama. I don't want any of that stuff. And that's not what it is. It's just to point out to you guys my own story. I'm sharing this from my own thing. I'm not asking for sympathy. I'm not asking for anything from telling this story, other than to show you guys that you can fall in the wrong hands in this independent Scientology world and the free zone, and people come up with their own levels, and they get people under their spell and paying all this money. You need correction. You need to do ethics. Oh, let's find the suppressive person in your life. And at this time in my life, it didn't get any better. And then I'm just being honest to say that, like, yeah, okay, it was kind of nice to have someone listen to me. But again, I don't need to pay all that money. Never took up into the counseling about my family problems. They could have maybe even hired me for a job if they really want to. They never hired me, never helped me with anything to lead me. And again, they don't have to. But again, if you're a life coach, maybe you help the person with coming up brainstorming for job ideas or what you should do with your life. This was before hairdressing school and all that stuff. They didn't help me with that. My relationship, again, we didn't do any of the counseling because she wanted $10,000 from my husband, trying to be like, hey, how can we get $10,000 from him? Asking me, and it's like, are you trying to trick my husband just to do like overts and withholds write-ups? Like, again, that's beyond me. Like, it's also another big thing too. Like, don't tell other people how I audit or how long the sessions were, or that you're going in a session with me. And this person got upset on multiple occasions. One time, because I hinted to Louis Theroux of the BBC that this person helped me. I didn't say that she audited me, but he must have known that she was an auditor and asked her, like, oh, are you auditing Steve Mango? And she blew up. She doesn't want to come under scrutiny because she is this big critic, and she doesn't want people to know she's secretly charging all this money to get people to go into session. I'm sure I'll get shit for posting this, but oh well. At least the other independent Scientologists, like, no matter like how I feel about them, what you guys believe about them, they're up front saying, like, I'm an auditor. This person is like, I'm not an auditor, don't worry, like I used to be. I hate L. Ron Hubbard. It's all a cult. It's all a scam. Let's expose Scientology 7 days a week, all around the clock. This person's posting on the internet about how horrible Scientology is. And on the flip side, it's like, oh, let me go take someone in a session. Oh, like, let me pause the Scientology session we're in right now, counseling you, and going out to make blog posts about how Scientology is evil. Like, that's why I just feel the most ripped off about this. And I feel the most deceived, because if this person just was like a believer and I paid them for it and that was that, okay. But I'm telling you guys, at the same time this was happening, they were saying it was all a scam. So it was just, again, a way to rip me off. And I haven't talked to this person maybe in like 2 years or so. Like, again, I'm in their Facebook groups and stuff like that. And again, like I said, I don't hate this person, but I just feel like they really did me dirty in this, in a time of my life when I was at my lowest. I can go to a nursing home and get someone to sign me over their home. Yes, that person's a legal adult, and yes, they could have handed over the deed to the home to me. Who's the sucker at that point? You know what I mean? Like, are you going to say that old person's a sucker to sign the home over to me? Or are you going to say that I manipulated that person? And I truly feel like I was manipulated into it. If this person had the conscience and the ethics and all those sort of things, and when I wasn't getting results and when I was telling them I was, you know, committing suicide and they wanted me to give them more money and not to get mental health services and all these different things, like maybe the person would have had some conscience to be like, hey, let me give you your money back. Like, I'm never expecting the person to ever show me a dime, even though, you know, would that have been the right thing or is the right thing to do? Yes, but again, that's not why I'm making this video. Obviously, it's not anything about that. It's just more the idea of that you don't know in the independent world of Scientology who has the right intentions behind these auditing sessions and stuff, because anything kind of happened because it's not regulated by Scientology. But again, Scientology is run by a cult leader. Scientology is a criminal dictatorship organization. Like, it's not like that even means anything, even if you were in Scientology and you were being overlooked by a case supervisor and overlooked by proper terminals, and there's cramming and there's ethics and all these different things. Again, that doesn't mean anything because it's all just Looney Tunes baloney, you know what I mean? Like, it doesn't mean anything. So yeah, I mean, after that time, like I said, I went into session with someone like Trey Lotz, and I felt like he's actually a good auditor and he's not trying to rip me off. Like, he would do it, and again, for what it's worth, it was more the sort of thing where, like, say he charges $100 an hour, whatever it is. I don't recall off the top of my head. If you go in for a session and you just want to talk to him about a problem for like 20, 30 minutes, he'll charge you like $30 or $40, like whatever like it breaks down to. He's not asking for thousands of dollars up front, right? So that's why I felt like a little bit better, like at least in his case, and he's a true diehard believer. And he's not like going on his computer at the same token saying like, oh my God, Scientology is a scam and it doesn't work and all this stuff, and then taking the person into session. Maybe this person needs, you know, to get their own mental health therapy or something like that. I don't know. I just know that I'm not the only person that feels this way. I know that other people have gotten into different debacles with this person. I know that at one point, Schenkelberg had problems with this person. Karen Presley, who randomly unfriended me on Facebook the other day, so I don't know what her problem is with me, but again, I don't really understand the ex-Scientologists. They all have like these little games that they play with each other, but she had an issue with this person. Just like various different people, and I don't know, I just feel that was kind of the situation with this independent Scientologist, was like, okay, it's all just kind of, it's all a scam, more or less, in the sense that because someone's doing it outside the church doesn't necessarily mean it's more pure, it's real, that they have good intentions. It could very much well just be a money-making scam. So I lost $575 in it, and now I am a bigger person, I'm smarter, I don't let people deceive me or trick me, or I don't fall for false promises or false prophets. Like, I truly genuinely feel more secure in myself, even though I still do have problems in a lot of different ways. I do feel like I'm in a better place in my life, and whether all these different things have happened to me, I learned the hard way with Scientology, with this ex-Scientologist, with a lot of different situations, but I learned, like, hey, you can't make me post different things on Facebook for you. You can't tell me, like, she'd call up my husband and be like, have him delete these videos. He can't say this or that. He shouldn't tell people on the internet he's depressed and anxious. Like, it's bad public relations for not only just him, but also for ex-Scientologists, because then the cult thinks that, you know, they won and all this stuff. Like, I don't care about my public relations. I'm honest and open with you guys on my channel. Maybe some people think I have ulterior motives on my videos or my channels, or I was looking for fame or attention years ago when I was like getting into Scientology to be an actor. With my true heart and everything, like, anyone who actually knows me could attest to this and say that my heart is in the right place when I do these videos and when I share with you my truth, like, heart and soul. Like, I'm honest, I'm upfront, I don't BS, I don't let people tell me what I can post, what I can't, what to believe and what not to. I am my own person. I am Stephen Mango. I believe in what Stephen Mango believes in, and I'm not gonna let someone control me. I don't want someone to have power over my life. I don't want anyone to tell me what to do, and whether that makes me stubborn or whatever, I don't care, because I want to live a life where I'm free and not feeling like a slave under someone. Like, someone else can save me. Someone else, please help me. Someone else take me out of the trenches and pull me up. I'm the only person who's responsible for doing that for myself, and I learned that, and it's much more liberating. But yeah, I pray that this person doesn't have more victims that they're doing this to, and I wish them the best to heal in their experience. And again, I hope that this wasn't in their eyes, seen as an attack. They always think people are trying to comfort them or attack them, or it's like us against them type of thing. And it's really not. It's just honest criticism. It doesn't matter if they're an ex-Scientologist, it doesn't matter if they're a man on the street. I can still share my own personal story, and that's all there is to it with that. I hope one day I can find more spirituality or something that can kind of fulfill me in that regard. I don't know if I ever will. I want to take you guys on the journey if you want to be on my spiritual journey with me to kind of discovering that. And I don't know if any of you guys are in that same place in life, but I'm doing it and I'm working on myself and I'm sharing that with you guys here on my channel. So subscribe if you guys want to see more of that. And I'm open and honest with my mental health on this channel. I'm not going to pretend I'm perfect. I'm not going to tell you guys one thing. If I'm hurting, I'm not going to say I'm not, just because I don't want Scientology to think that. I opened up, I was honest about my borderline personality disorder, my anxiety, my depression, and my struggles here over the course of the last couple of years. And this is very real of how the healing process is of Scientology. And I'm going to make a video as well about codependence in Scientology. And there's like a lot of really interesting elements I want to share with you guys. And again, I'm not a victim. I am a survivor. And I just want you guys all to remember that, even if the story sounds like I'm telling it in the sense of like, oh my God, like poor me, like it's really not. I'm on the other end and I'm not under that person's spell anymore. So I'm really curious to hear what you guys think about the independent Scientology movement and my experience with this ex-Scientologist down in the comment box down below. Make sure to give this video a thumbs up. I'll be posting more videos for you over the next couple days. I love you guys and I'll see you in my next video. Bye guys.